morning. It is great to be gathering here this morning on Mother's Day. I do know that there's a few people who are involved in Mother's Day things this morning, but it's great for the rest of us to be gathering here for worship today. We'll be acknowledging Mother's Day in a little while, but I think it's wonderful that our Bible reading today speaks a little bit about God's unconditional love for us. And on a day like today, I think love is a good thing. We're going to start our service this morning by singing our introit, just the first verse of hymn number 107, Sing Praise and Thanksgiving. Let us continue with our prayers of adoration and gathering. Let's pray. God of love, Scripture reminds us that in you every family on earth receives its name. This morning as we come to worship you, we ask that you shine your light on us and pour on us your life-giving water. We thank you for the gifts of love we have received, and on this day that we are thinking about those people who have cared, loved and nurture us, we particularly thank you for those who have mothered us, nourished us, guiding us as we grow to be the people who we are. As we have been loved by them, so we are also loved by you, O God. So this morning we praise you for your presence with us and rejoice in being loved. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our first hymn is hymn number 152, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You.
Thank you.
Our responsive psalm comes from Psalm 117, which is actually not a very long psalm at all. Now, I'll read the first part of the psalm, and I encourage you to read out the bolded section. Praise the Lord.
All your nations.
Praise Him.
All your people of the earth.
For God's merciful kindness is great towards us.
The Lord's faithfulness endures forever.
Praise the Lord. As I was saying at the beginning of the service, today is Mother's Day, and today is a day where we pause and reflect upon those who have played that mothering role in our lives. It can be a complicated day because not all mothering relationships can have been perfect. Some people would have loved to be mothers but did not have that opportunity. Some people are mothers, but the relationship is not as healthy as they would like it to be. And for probably most of us here, our own mothers are no longer with us, although my mother is. But it's one of those sort of things that it can bring a tinge of sadness. But I still think it's important for us to pause and to give thanks to God for our mothers or any of the people who have been in our lives who have played that mothering role. I hope that as you were coming in that you got a mothering gift. Did you see that as you came in? Yes. Can I just borrow yours, Robin? That the kids from Kids Church did some drawings last week for Mother's Day. And so if there's not enough of those, I can make sure that there's some more around. But I hope that you all got some, felt the love of the kids from Kids Church. And I've got a prayer which was written by Reverend John Humphreys, just as an acknowledgement of Mother's Day. And I'd love to pray that for us now. So let's pray. God, both mother and father for humankind and creation. We are grateful and thankful for mothering, for the feminine touch of parenting, for the special connection of mother and child, and thankful for all the women in our lives who offer care, comfort, encouragement, and support. We are grateful for the self-sacrifice of love that is given, and we offer our love in returns. We remember the mothers who are. We remember the mothers who have been and are gone. We remember the mothers who can't be. We acknowledge that mothering is hard and not all are able to do so as they would like. We acknowledge that we fall short in life and love and that our mothers are no exception in this. However, today we honour mothering, especially those who give of their best. We pray for mothers all, for those who offer mothering beyond the circles of bloodlines and family. For the mothers and motherers, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we prepare to hear our Bible reading, as we've been talking about love today, I remember this old hymn that I don't think we've sung for a little while here. In loving kindness, Jesus came to remind us of that sense of God's love and kindness for us. And so let's sing together the wonderful hymn, In Loving Kindness, Jesus Came.
Thank you.
We're going to be hearing for our Bible reading today from Romans chapter 5. It's just a fantastic reading that speaks of God's love for us. Robin is coming to bring that for us today. I just need to find a glass of water.
Peace and hope. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we've now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. And this is the word of the Lord.
Last Sunday, Kevin started us on our journey through Romans. We're actually going to be spending about 8 weeks in the book of Romans, which sounds like a long time, but there's a lot in Romans. And that you'll see as we work through this, it's a very theologically dense book of the Bible. Last week, Kevin gave us a quick summary of the book of Romans. I think he used this slide, and just gives you an outline of what Romans is about. But I was going to do a little bit more value adding to the context of Romans, and I've got a few questions to ask you. See how good your biblical knowledge is. Are you ready for this? Who wrote Romans? The Apostle Paul wrote Romans, yes. When was it written? Kevin said it last week. Yeah, it was around about 57, 58 CE. It's one of the last books of the Bible that was written. So, and out of all the letters, it's the last of the letters that was written. Paul had already done most of his journey and missionary journeys by that point. And the last one, who was it written to?
Citizens of Rome.
Yes. Well, actually, technically it was written to the church in Rome. But yeah, that's why we call it the Romans, because it was written to the Romans. But the Roman church is a bit unique compared to most of the other churches around the Mediterranean and the early church. Unlike most of the other churches, the church at Rome was not set up by Paul or any of the other missionary people like Barnabas or Silas or anyone else. But rather, it was probably started up by the Jewish Christians who'd come to Pentecost, you know, when they all came to Jerusalem. And the Spirit descended at the day of Pentecost. And if you read in Acts chapter 2, verse 10, it talks about how lots of different people were there, including residents of Rome. And they think that the people who were there went back to Rome and established the church then. And it was interesting because Paul had never visited the church in Rome. He spoke about it numerous times, about wanting to visit them, but hadn't actually got there. And if you know your Bible history, did actually get there at the end, but not on his own accord, but rather as a prisoner of the emperor at that point. Now, by putting some pieces of the Bible together, we believe that the original church leaders were Priscilla and her husband Aquila. I told you a few weeks ago when I was talking about diversity that women in leadership were coming. They just hadn't quite got there early in Acts. But this is one of the examples of women in leadership. And initially, as I said, the church would have mainly been Jewish people who had been at the Pentecost and come back. But there probably was non-Jewish people who joined them over the time as well. And that would have brought the same issues as we talked about a few weeks ago with Peter and Cornelius, of how do you bring those two cultures together. But something happened in 49 CE that turned the Roman church upside down. The Emperor Claudius, out of total frustration having to deal with the squabbles of the Jewish people, did something extraordinary, and he banned all Jewish people from Rome for a period of time. Basically kicked them all out for a period of time. So you could just well imagine the early church, which was mainly Jewish people, suddenly most of them had just been kicked out. And so where did the Roman church go from there? Well, the non-Jewish people probably would have had to step up into the leadership positions and started to run the church themselves. Eventually, Claudius did allow the Romans to come back again, and so they returned, but that caused a whole lot of tension because you had all the original leaders like Priscilla and Aquila, and you also had all these new leaders who had been running the church for a while, and when they came together, they had to try and work out, well, who was the leaders? And they had some differing opinions in theology and also how to be a Christian. And that's where the tension was. And that's why Paul wrote the letter of Romans, to address some of these tensions in differing understandings of practice and theology. Does that make sense? That's why Romans was written. Kevin said this to you last week, but Romans can basically be split into two sections. And it's based around this one verse. Romans 12 verse 1 is where it splits into two. And you can look up different translations, but they all basically say the same thing. It says, therefore, in the light of everything we've told you up to this point, brothers and sisters, we want you to, and a dot, 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 and it gives a whole list of instructions. So what Paul really does in the first 11 chapters spends all this time talking about the theology of God's mercy and grace, understanding that. And then from verse 12 onwards, chapter 12 onwards, he goes, well, in the light of all that, this is what you should do. This is the practice of being a Christian. That sort of makes sense. It's split into two. Now, we're not up to chapter 12 yet. We're way back in chapter 5. And actually, Kevin did chapter 1 last week. So what happens in the four chapters in between? Let me give you a quick summary to catch you up. So Paul is basically making a single point going over and over again in the four chapters leading up to chapter 5. And some of these verses, I'll read them out just as a highlight, but you'll get what Paul's saying. So he starts off by saying, through Jesus we have received grace. Last week Kevin talked about Paul saying, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it has the power of God that brings salvation to everyone. He goes on to say, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law, but rather the law helps us to realize or to be conscious of our sin. Then we get to this beautiful verse from verse 23 and 24. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by God's grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. 3:28, we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sins the Lord will never count against them. And verse 23 and 24, God will credit righteous for us who believe in him who raised Jesus from the dead. He delivered us over to death for our sins and raised us to life for our justification. Did you get all that? Paul does use a lot of words to say it. But in all those chapters, he's basically saying that a person is not made right with God by following the law, but rather by accepting God's grace given to them. That's what the first four chapters are about. Actually, it's what the next few chapters are about as well, as we're just about to see. Paul also uses two words a lot. It's probably helpful if we just do a quick definition. Righteousness and justified. They're very similar words, but they're not the same. Righteous is the process of being made right with God. However you want to understand that. Paul's theology is that when we sin, or when we fall short of God's glory, that there is a separation between us and God. There's a break in our relationship. And righteousness is that process where we are reconciled back with God, when we are made right with God. The Old Testament of the Bible would say righteousness comes through following God's law. But Paul is going, no one can do that. Nobody can be made right that way. We're not that good. So he's saying the only way that we can be made right with God is through God's grace, when God chooses for us to be right again. Now, justification, or being justified, is very similar, but not the same. In Christian terms, justified is having your sins forgiven, having your slate cleaned, having your sins washed away, being made pure, whatever you want to use that phrase. Justification is part of the process of being made right, but it's that part where our sins are forgiven. Have you heard that last little bit before where it says justified is just if I'd never sinned? It's very good if you haven't heard it before. But it's a good understanding of what, in Christian terms, being justified means. So you can sort of see they're similar. Being made right with God and being justified are similar, but they're not quite the same. Same, same, but different. All right. Have I caught you up? We're just about to jump into Romans chapter 5 and briefly look at what Paul is trying to say in this chapter. Paul starts off by reminding us yet again, therefore, since we have been justified, what does justified mean? Our sins are forgiven. So just as our sins have been forgiven through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace which we now stand. Paul says in about 50 words what he could say in 10 words. He does use a lot of words. They're beautiful words, no doubt. But yeah, Paul is just saying we are justified, our sins are forgiven because of God's grace to us. And then Paul goes off on a little tangent in verse 5 and talks about just as we celebrate God's grace, we should also celebrate those times of suffering too. Because suffering produces perseverance, perseverance produces character, and that ultimately leads to hope. Have you ever had that experience? Not that we would want difficult times to come upon anybody or ourselves, but have you ever had those experiences when you've lived through a difficult time and you can look back and you sort of see, well, I wouldn't want to choose to do that, but during that time, I discovered a strength within me to get me through, to help me persevere. And through that perseverance, I'm developed as a person. My character is developed. And as that is happening in a way that we don't understand, we end up finding a sense of, through our faith, hope. Have you ever had those experiences? Like, what Paul is saying is true. Anyway, enough of that tangent. Paul snaps right back to the point he is trying to make about faith and justification. He goes on to sort of say, well, to do some interesting time analysis when it comes to our faith. And I had a bit of a play with this yesterday as I'm sitting at my computer going, what is Paul trying to say here? And I've come up with this graph. And for the people watching online, I'll put this on the screen as well. And so I've got here, how does this work? We sin, we all fall short of the glory of God. We cry out to God for help, and God hears our cry and is merciful. And so Jesus dies for our sins, and we are justified, and we are made right with God again. Does that sound pretty good? Is that what Paul's saying in Romans chapter 5? Sort of, but not quite. Paul actually does a little bit of a twist on this to show us something quite profound. You see, to the question that this asks is God's mercy a compassionate response to us calling out for help? Like, does God hear us go, help, we can't do this by ourselves? And God says, oh, they need some help. We better sort out this problem. Jesus, you better go and die, and so they can be reconciled. It's not a response to what we've done. What Paul's trying to show is something slightly different. And I came up with this little map here. What Paul is saying is that God has loved us from the beginning. I actually think it's quite neat that on Mother's Day I'm talking about God's unconditional love. But it's a bit like Paul saying, before we even had an understanding of what's going on, God loved us. God loved us. And God sent Jesus to die for us before we even responded. And so, yeah, when we sin and cry out to God for help, yes, God is merciful to us and can reconcile us. Why? Because God has already done what was needed for that to happen. Christ has already died. Can you see the profoundness in this? So this is what Paul's trying to say, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Before we even had a chance to think about what we needed to do to solve this problem, God already says, I've already done it. I've already done it. I've already solved the problem. Christ has already died and risen again. All this has happened before you even realized. Why is this important? Because Paul was trying to make it perfectly clear that this is about God, not about us. This starts with God. It's not a response to us crying out for help. It starts with God. That it's instigated by God. It's paid for by God. We are just the recipients of it. It's actually all about God. God demonstrates God's love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Are you getting that? It's a profound little gem that sits in chapter 5, that God did all this before we even had a chance to respond. But there's a problem with this. If this is the case, if God's already done all the work before we even have a chance to respond, then that can be opened up to being misused. Because you could argue, couldn't somebody lead a life of godlessness, you know, full of sin and other stuff, and as long as they keep on asking God every now and again to forgive them, it doesn't matter what they do? Well, yes, that is the problem. There is a loophole here that is a bit of a difficulty. But don't worry, I get to preach on that next week when I get to do Romans chapter 6. And if you think I'm excited about preaching about Romans 5, wait till next week. It's even better. And so there is a problem that comes up with the fact that God's already done all the work before us. It can be misused, but God also has an ability to address that and work through that. We'll look at that next week. But for the moment, I just want us to hear the good news of Romans chapter 5, that God loves us unconditionally. That right from the very beginning, God loves us. And while our connection with God might have been broken at different points, God's love for us never changed. And God's love for us is not dependent on whether or not we are right with God or whether we cry out to God. God just loves us. And so before we could even try and fix anything to do with this brokenness or separation from God, God has already done it. Out of God's love for us, Christ died for us. We are offered this free gift of mercy and grace. God offers to reconcile us, to make us right again, to justify us, and through the resurrection of Jesus offers us life. All that's already happened. All we have to do is accept it. I'm going to say amen and finish the sermon at this point, but let me tell you again, it's not the end of the sermon. There's another one coming next week that puts the second half to this and explains what happens with that loophole of grace and how God helps us to grow. We'll talk about that next week. Let's reflect upon this as we sing. Well, if I'm talking about grace, I could not go past hymn number 129, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. And as we sing this hymn, we are going to take up the offering. Let's sing together hymn number 129, Amazing Grace. Let's come before God with our prayers of intercession. Let's pray. Merciful God, we do not understand the suffering faced by so many in this world. We do not understand it, and yet we ask for your strength as we and others endure this suffering and respond to it. May our responses build up our character and give us hope that we might make a difference. May we listen to your Holy Spirit who guides us in your ways. Help us to love others as you love us. May we be your hands, offering a touch of healing and comfort. We just pause in our prayers to remember the people that we may know who might need our prayers at this time. Lord God, we pray for ourselves. Help us to make time for our friends, our brothers and sisters, and even those people that we might have difficult relationships with. Transform us through your reconciling relationship that you have with us. Help us to be confident followers of Jesus, to be bold with our words and our actions in this world, our community, our city. Unite us in love, and may that love flow out from us to everyone we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We come to our final hymn as we think about God's grace and love for us. To God be the glory, great things he has done. I said at the beginning, Mother's Day can be a little complicated for people, but it is a day that we do reflect on love and the love that has been shown to us by different people in our lives. And so as I pray that as we head out from this service, that not only have we experienced God's love to us today, but that we might experience this week and be encouraged to share that love with others. And may the blessing of God in all God's fullness, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, continue to be with you and your loved ones today and forever. Amen.
Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God,
thank you for joining with us, especially thank you for the people who have joined with us online. We look forward to connecting next week as we move into Romans chapter 6. If you need to contact me or Kevin for any reason, our phone number's on the screen. Bye for now.